and welcome to the Atlas Agency, where we investigate the Arkham Horror Living Card Game. Today I'm covering the Carnival of Horrors expansion. Carnival of Horrors is a print-on-demand standalone scenario, and in this video I'll explain exactly what that means, then I'll tell you about Carnival of Horrors and give my thoughts on it. Carnival of Horrors is the second print-on-demand standalone scenario to be released for the Arkham LCG. It came out in December 2016, about a month after the core set was first released, and it was sort of an unexpected surprise since it was first announced on the very same day that it was released. Before I review the scenario, I want to stop and explain the differences between these print-on-demand scenarios and the normal types of Arkham LCG expansion, just in case you're not familiar. Each of these standalone scenarios contains a single all-new scenario. Unlike Mythos packs and deluxe expansions, these don't contain any player cards for general deck building. These scenarios don't use any encounter sets from any other expansions, so to play them you don't need any other purchases aside from your core set. You only need one copy of Carnival of Horrors to play the scenario with anywhere from 1 to 4 players, as long as you have enough player cards to build 4 legal decks. As the name suggests, these expansions are one-off scenarios that aren't tied to any specific campaign the way the regular releases are. There are two ways you can play these. The first option is just to play them as pure standalone experiences, where you just take a deck and play the scenario by itself. The other way you can play the scenario is as a side quest during a campaign, so you're required to spend a certain number of experience points to go on the side quest. That's 3 experience from each investigator in the case of Carnival. And then you just play it between 2 other scenarios in your campaign. They contain some special bonuses and sometimes also penalties that you can acquire through the scenario, and you carry those forward with you when you return to your regular campaign. The card count in these packs is typically 62 cards. Those cards are all you get in these. Unlike the Mythos packs, there's no printed paper insert. That means a handful of the cards just have the scenario setup and resolution text printed on them. Even with a few cards eaten up by that text, these scenarios have a noticeably higher card count than most scenarios in the regular releases. That extra space means these scenarios tend to have a bigger and more epic feel to them. The other thing I want to explain before we start talking about Carnival itself is that print-on-demand tag. Print-on-demand means that these products use a different printing process from the regular Arkham expansions. They're still sold through regular retail channels, but they're printed in-house by Fantasy Flight instead of by the usual printer. That means the cards will have a slightly different look and texture from your other cards. Since the encounter cards don't get mixed with any other encounter cards, it doesn't matter too much there. However, that can be an issue for the cards that get mixed into the player decks, since you may be able to tell by looking when a card from a standalone is the top card of your deck. If that bothers you, you can solve the issue by sleeving your player cards in opaque sleeves. Okay, so enough about the format, let's get on to talking about the scenario itself. So the story behind Carnival of Horrors is that the investigators have traveled all the way to Venice, Italy, which is in the middle of a city-wide carnival festival. As you would expect from Arkham, sinister forces are at work behind the scenes, and it's up to the players to intervene and put a stop to things. Carnival of Horrors has a couple of unique mechanical twists to it. I want to talk a little bit about the way the scenario works. Nothing too spoilery, just stuff you'd know by either reading the Fantasy Flight preview article or looking at the cards when you first get the scenario set up. One of the major elements of Carnival is the way it handles its locations. In Carnival, the locations are set out randomly in a giant circle, and the location connections are all one-directional. It's sort of like a big clock face where you can only move clockwise. It's a pretty unique setup, and the scenario leans heavily on it. It uses movement as a part of its challenge, so the map sometimes feels like it's another one of the enemies that you're facing. Spread onto this map, you have these double-sided masked carnival-goer assets. On the side that starts face up, these are all the same, but on their reverse sides, the unmasked sides, some of them have enemies and some of them have innocent bystanders that you're tasked with rescuing. So part of the scenario is figuring out who is who so that you can lead the right people to safety. Because of those movement restrictions, even when you know who's who, it can still be a challenge to reach them and get them where they need to go. So these two elements, the movement and the revelers, give Carnival a really unique identity. Feels quite unlike any of the other scenarios. I consider Carnival to be a very strong scenario, both thematically and mechanically. It feels, as I said, quite a bit different from any other adventure published so far, and since it doesn't reuse any outside encounter sets, every card is unique to the scenario, and the cards are all able to play off of the scenario's unique structure. There are about 10 different unique cards between the treacheries and the enemies, and they're all specifically wired for Carnival of Horrors. The mechanics I explained earlier describe the objective and the board state at the start of the scenario, but that board state does develop in interesting ways as the scenario progresses. I have to mention the finale, which is particularly good and has a very epic feel to it. It's one of the most memorable and exciting scenario finales in the game, maybe even the most memorable and exciting. I think the theming in this expansion is very strong as well. The artwork does a great job of establishing this Venice setting. There was actually an expansion for the previous Call of Cthulhu LCG that was also set in Venice, so Fantasy Flight was able to make good use of some pre-existing artwork for this one. The theme and setting are integrated very well into the scenario's mechanics. The restricted movement rules do give the feeling of being caught up in a festival procession or parade, and the double-sided cards are a great way to do that theme of Venetian masks, where you don't know whether the reverse side of the card is an enemy or an ally until you remove the mask. The enemies you face all feel like natural fits for the setting, and nothing feels out of place. It's just a very cohesive expansion. I think overall this one handles its theme really well, and I think it does a much better job on this front than the other standalone, Curse of the Rougarou. So that's what I like about Carnival of Horrors, and to be honest, there isn't a whole lot about it that I dislike. The only issues I really want to bring up relate to the way this scenario fits into a campaign when you use it as a side quest. So there are two parts to this. First, as a side quest, Carnival seems somewhat steeply priced at 3 experience points. Curse of the Rougarou, the other standalone, only costs 1. Now, there are scenario rewards that make up for that, but getting the best reward requires success in the scenario, and it's a tough scenario, so it's no guarantee. If you do poorly, there's a chance you're going to come out of this one worse than you went in. That said, this was probably a bigger issue when Carnival first came out, and now that Dunwich has deepened the pool of player cards, the scenario should be at least a little easier. We also now have the player card Delve Too Deep, which makes it a little easier to get a net experience gain out of this side quest. Second, while the Venice setting is really great and works well for the adventure, as a side quest, it doesn't really make narrative sense in a campaign. Neither of the currently released campaigns really has any downtime story-wise, so it's weird to have the adventurers pause the action for a trip to Italy. The other standalone is set in New Orleans, and even that trip is hard to justify, but this one's much worse. If this matters to you, you can do what I think most people do and rationalize this as a flashback to an earlier adventure, but I think it's at least worth mentioning, even if it's just as a nitpick. So for those two reasons, I like this one a little bit more for standalone mode. So there you have it, the Carnival of Horrors standalone scenario. As always, thanks for watching. For more Arkham LCG content, please check out our blog at atlasofarkham.wordpress.com and subscribe to this YouTube channel. Thanks!